I mean, I'm a big fan of waffles, so syrup. I'm around syrup quite a bit. And we're at a Holiday Inn Express. So the breakfast buffet there is where they have the cereal where you turn the knob and like four pieces fall out. It's like how you feed a cat for a long weekend, you know? And you're like, that's enough. They had batter and syrup. And so you pour the, but they had the waffle iron where you make it yourself. So you pour the batter on the waffle iron, you shut it, you turn it over, it locks, it cooks for 2 minutes, you turn it over, you open it, half the waffle comes off, half stays forever. That's how you eat a waffle. So I'm with my buddy of mine that's my age. So we go through, he's in front of me, not really talking or anything, just going through. He gets to it, it's batter and syrup, they're in clear containers. They're not labeled, but they're in clear containers. He gets the syrup and starts pouring it on the waffle iron. And I'm not even stopping him, because he's not doing it where he's going, I've never done that. He's doing it where we're probably going to try it after. I mean, he's just like, we're like, dude, I can't wait to see what this guy's making. Like, he might know something that I don't know. He shuts it, turns it over, it cooks. He's like looking at us, we're like, I mean, the whole line's like, yeah, what is that going to be? And it makes black smoke is what it makes. Just, I mean, dark black smoke. Just starts filling the lobby. The manager comes over. He's like, what are you doing? He's like, I guess I poured the wrong one. These are not labeled. And the guy's like, they're in clear containers. Do you not know the difference of batter and syrup? And he's like, I bet it happens all the time. He goes, I've worked here my whole life and I've never seen this. So they threw the waffle iron, and they just throw it away. That's what they have to do. Just throw it away. It's over. And now there's no waffle. I mean, we went from all about to get a waffle to it's upside down in a trash can. And then he just turns and looks, and it's just a line of people with that little foam plate. And just everybody's sad. I just hear someone in the back go like, I set my alarm for this.
Man, that's so good, right? I mean, have you ever found yourself there where, like, you're looking around and people are doing something different than you thought, and you're like, oh, maybe I'm missing something right here. So you just, like, join in, right? You're like, start doing what they're doing, and, you know, we do that with our lives in so many ways. I mean, we just start, you know, kind of scheduling the way everybody runs their lives, and we start spending the way they're spending, and, you know, doing our relationships and all the complexities that come, and we're like, oh, apparently they know something I don't know, and I need to get in on that game. And, you know, before long, you look up, and all of a sudden, like everything is up in black smoke and you don't know what went wrong. So we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about, you know, how your inclination and my inclination is just to constantly do more, and how we fill every single space in our calendars and in our schedules, and we ended up not really enjoying much of what we do. And so we're going to look at how to solve that. We're going to look at kind of how to, what a solution is there. And maybe you're like, hey, yeah, I'm not there right now. We're going to give you some tools on how to prevent yourself from getting there. So, man, so good to be with you guys today. So excited to have you here. Let's make some noise for the online crowd. Join us at YouTube Online, Crosspoint Online. Man, so good to have you guys joining us in that online space. My name's Kurt, and if you're here for the first time, whether it's online or in the room, man, we are so excited you're here. And let me catch you up on where we've been. Last week, we began this four-part series talking about something really applicable and relevant to all of us, just this need that I think we all have to kind of like just get some room and some space in our lives for the things that matter the most. And somebody said to me this week, they're like, Kurt, I need that an application for every area of my life. And I'm like, we're not necessarily going to be talking about that, but I know we do. And so maybe for you, I don't know if anybody has, you know, like a desk that looks like this right here. Maybe have a desk, you don't have to raise your hand, but like, you know, you certainly could apply some of this to that. Some of us have closets, like you walk into your bedroom and like this is you trying to find your stuff. And some of you are getting like really anxious right now. You're like, oh my gosh, that just creates so much anxiety just seeing that. You know, it's just so chucked full. And then others of you are like, you know, what? Like, what's wrong with that? And so, you know, while it's one thing for your closet and your desk and you know, perhaps your car, the backseat of your car, or, you know, your garage to look like this. You know, and listen, God, you know, made us all different. So, you know, if that works for you, cool. For me, I when I like do work, I got to clean this space up, make sure it's all kind of in its place before I can, you know, kind of be creative. Others of you, you just like sit in it and you're like, man, it doesn't bother me at all, right? And so, in fact, let's just have a moment of confession. How many of us have some space in our home, our lives, whether it's a closet, a, you know, your car, a drawer, the basement that kind of looks a bit like this? It's just kind of chock full, yeah. And keep your hands up for a second, just out of curiosity. How many of you like it? And it's like not a problem. Like, yeah, that's good. And then some of you, you look at this and you're like, well, gosh, they could go out, shop some more. They got lots of room. You know, you're like, there's always room for more, right? Because that's just how we live. That's what we look around and see. And so in this series, honestly, I don't care, you know, what your closet looks like or your desk or your car, you know, for the most part. But I do care about what your life looks like. And I think God really cares. He knows how we're wired to work. And I don't want your schedule to look this way, or your finances and spending, or your, you know, relationships and all the complexities that come when we're trying to be efficient in our relationships. And so just so we're all kind of on the same page, last week we said white space is the space between our current pace and our limits, meaning the distance or the space between, you know, how fast I'm running, how much I'm spending, how, you know, efficiently I'm trying to manage my relationships and all the complexities that come with that. I mean, our current pace and our limits, because we discovered we have limits. We all have limits, whether we want to admit it or not. And so today we're going to talk about our schedule. We're going to talk about how do we kind of apply some things that just work from God into our lives and our schedule. Because again, your inclination, my inclination is to add stuff but never take anything out. And we like to just, you know, kind of put more and more in, and then we don't end up enjoying anything that we're doing. And, you know, you could, you know, find an app or go to a time, you know, management seminar. I mean, those are certainly options. And if that's your, you know, kind of deal, like, certainly go for that. The problem sometimes with, like, time management seminars, for instance, is, you know, at the end of the day, they're trying to, like, just sell you a product. And so that's cool if, like, it works for you, but it might be that your personality is just not wired, you know, in the way that product is geared to work. So it works for a while, and you do it, and then one day you're just like, yeah, it's not working, and you just quit doing it. And then you're, like, right back to where you started. And so, I mean, there's lots of things we could talk about, but I'm excited because we're going to look at one thing, one big idea, one application that I just think literally can change your life, can change the way you see things, the way you do things. And the reason it will create some change is because it will change your time. And I don't know if you know this or not, but your time is your life, meaning your schedule kind of is your life. And so we're going to kind of go after this big game-changing idea, and it comes from, of all people, you know, that we kind of see within the Bible, a guy by the name of Moses. And so, you know, if you want to follow along in your Bible or your Bible app, or you have the old school, like, papal version at home, or you're sitting there with it, like, by all means, you can go to Psalm 90. We're going to go to Psalm 90. And usually when we think of the Psalms, we think of David. But this psalm is written by a guy named Moses. Now, here's why Moses is so fascinating. Moses had four different lives, four different kind of iterations or reiterations of his life. And so the first one was like when Moses was raised in Pharaoh's household in Egypt. He was a Hebrew, but he was raised in the Egyptian leader's home because he was adopted. And basically had everything he wanted. I mean, he had like the 80-inch, you know, 8K, you know, big screen TV in every room. I mean, he just had it made. Everything was going great for him. And then one day he killed a guy in the kingdom and lost favor with the king. And so they kicked him out and said, you know, you're on your own. And this led him to his second kind of, you know, season of his life, which was where he was a shepherd. And, you know, you talk about slow days, all right? So when you're a shepherd, you walk the sheep out into the pasture and you sit there and you watch the sun come up from one side of the horizon to the other. And then you take the sheep back and then you go to sleep and you get up and do it all over again. And get this, he did this for 40 years. For 40 years, Moses did this. I mean, just think about that for a moment. For 40 years of his life. I mean, just day in, day out, same thing. And he I don't even know that he knew who he was. And he probably thought, you know, one day I'm going to watch some of these sheep die, and eventually I'm going to die, and, you know, my kids probably have a few kids, and hopefully they'll kind of remember me, but nobody's going to even know who I am. I mean, that's probably what he thought out in that field. I mean, little did he know we'd be talking about him, like, literally, like, thousands of years later. So that was, like, the second part of his life. And then the third part of his life, he ended up back in Egypt. And this was the whole, like, let my people go, you know, part. If you remember that part from, like, you know, the Ten Commandments, Charlton Heston, you know, up on the mountain. And this is the part where the plagues and, you know, he's fighting Pharaoh and saying, hey, you need to let my people go. And Pharaoh's not listening. And the river of blood, I mean, all these strange and weird things happen. And, you know, and now he's like God's mouthpiece for this whole nation. And I don't know if you know anything about Moses, but he didn't speak well. He had a stuttering problem. And he's like, so really, that's how you're going to do this? You're going to use me to, like, talk? And so, you know, he's got that thing going, and yet he's found himself at the epicenter of kind of the whole thing God's doing as, you know, he faces down with Pharaoh in Egypt. And then the fourth part of his life is where he leads a nation. And he kind of marches this group of people out of Egypt, and they're going to this land that God only knows. In fact, like, literally, God only knows. Like, nobody knows where they're going. God's like, hey, just go, and I'm going to show you. So God's the only one that knows. And he's marching them to this kind of promised land, and they're grumbling and bitching and moaning and all, you know, kind of complaining. And God gets angry with them. He's like, okay, we're not doing this. I'm so sick of this. So he just has Moses lead them around in circles for the rest of their life. He's like, I'm going to lead them in circles for 40 years until they just kind of die. You know, we'll get rid of them that way. I mean, isn't that awesome? Like, that's Moses' life. And so, I mean, he's raised in Pharaoh's house, and then he's a shepherd for 40 years. And then he is back, like, in the, kind of a big deal, and he's, you know, the whole, like, let my people go, and now he's, you know, leading a nation and just wandering around in circles. And then, kind of at the end of his life, I guess you'd call this the fifth part, he gets to this place, this promised land, and he's got all these people with him, and all of a sudden God says, Moses, you can't come in. You can't go into the place that I've been taking you to. And Moses is like, what are you talking about, Willis? He's like, what are you talking about? That's like for the handful of you over 40. He's like, what are you talking about? What do you mean I can't go in? I'm Moses. Like, I led the people here. He's like, you can't go in. I mean, here's what I'll let you do. I'll let you go up on this mountain where you can, like, peer. You can, like, look across the valley into this amazing place. It's flowing with milk and honey and goodness. But you can't go in. I mean, so this is a guy who has had a lot of experiences, and he understands time a bit and perspective on time. And he gives this all to us in the 90th Psalm. And in this psalm, I'm telling you, this is the context of every single decision that you and I make in regards to time. And so, again, it doesn't matter whether you're Christian, religious, irreligious, you know, whether you believe Moses really is a historical figure or not, none of that matters. I mean, this principle, if you'll just walk this out, it works, because it sets a context for, again, every decision we make in terms of how we use our time and what we cram in and what we pull out. So I'm going to read these verses to you. We're just going to kind of go by it, you know, kind of verse by verse. And I'm going to explain a bit. It's ancient Hebrew text, so it's kind of a little, you know, awkward translating the Hebrew back to English. And so in the end, though, we're going to get to this powerful, powerful thing that I think will really help us kind of look at life different. So Psalm 90, here we go. It says, Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Meaning, as a nation of Israel, our identity, you know, throughout our history has really been rooted in the context of who you are. He says, now before the mountains were born, I mean, just think about that for a moment. You ever thought about the moment the mountains were born? Before the mountains were born, you brought forth the whole world. I mean, he's a creationist. From everlasting to everlasting, you are God. And so he's like, all right, God, you're like the continuum. I mean, you're like the arrows going in both directions. You're everlasting to everlasting, and somewhere in the middle of the bookends of this continuum is me, Moses. And also is the nation of Israel, and is where you and I, somewhere between those bookends, find ourselves. And then he just makes this incredible statement. He says, you turn people back to dust, saying, return to dust, you mortals. I mean, this is like the greatest, you know, like Gandalf statement you'll ever hear in the Old Testament right here, right? I mean, he's like, return to dust, you shall not pass, you mortals. I mean, that is like, it's like our world meets, you know, Old Testament world together right here. And that might be a little offensive to you, but like Moses is like, yeah, I get it. I mean, this is just God's way of explaining, like, he controls the beginning and the end. Like, he is, like, the continuum. And this is the place where, like, you and I struggle a bit. This is where I struggle a bit, because we go, okay, so, like, does God, like, kill people then? Does God, like, cause things to happen to people? I don't know. Does God, like, decide one day, okay, you've lived enough days, so you're done? Or does he have in his mind ahead of time how many days you have? I don't really fully know that. What's probably most important to us is, you know, even though we don't fully know how to explain this, for most of us, we believe that God has something to do with the length of our days, how many days we have. And here's why I kind of believe that. Let me kind of like give you a question to see if you believe that. If you found out tomorrow, think about this. If you found out tomorrow that you have a terminal disease, would you pray? Or if you found out tomorrow that somebody close to you, a loved one, had a terminal disease, would you pray? You know, even if you haven't prayed in like a really, really long time, you'd probably go, yeah, I'd be like, oh my God, like please give them a little more time. Please give me a little more time. Help me to get through this. Or, you know, case in point on this, I mean, we think, again, back to a little over a week ago, the Bills-Bengals game where, you know, DeMar Hamlin went down with the cardiac arrest, and like all of a sudden, you just see like people getting together and praying. I mean, people probably haven't prayed in a long time. Circles around the field, the players, around the ambulance, you have commentary, like Adam Schefter talking about like, you know, we're all praying for this guy. You have, you know, guys like Scott Van Pelt on SportsCenter saying, obviously we're all praying. I'm like, oh my gosh, I've never heard these guys use this language, which just kind of goes to show that again, in moments like this, there's something in us that believes that somehow God has something to do with the number of our days. Moses goes on, he says, 1,000 years in your sight is like a day that has just gone by, or a watch, all right? Not a watch like on your wrist, but like a watch in the night, a period of time, which usually a watch was like 3 hours. In other words, Moses is saying, wow, I just keep feeling like, man, the years are just like flying by. You might feel that way. Oh my, the years just fly by. And yet the older I get, they go faster. But like, God, you're like everlasting to everlasting. You're like both ends of the continuum. And while for me, I'm like, oh my gosh, where'd the last 10 years go? For you, 1,000 years is like 3 hours or even just like 3 minutes. I mean, it's barely a flash in time. I don't know if you've ever heard the story about the banker who goes into a bar and talks to God. I don't know why he goes into a bar. I guess that's just how the joke always goes, but you ever heard this story? Like, so a banker goes in, you know, sits down and says, hey, God, I got a question. And God's like, yeah, what's your question? He says, is it true that like to you, you know, a minute is as if like 1,000 years to us? And God's like, yeah, I mean, that's time, space, continuum. That's how, you know, it all is. And he's like, all right, but is it true that like to you, like a dollar, you know, to you is like $1,000,000 to us? Yeah, I mean, yeah, it works differently in my economy. And the banker's like, okay, so do you think you could find it within yourself to just give me a dollar? And God's like, sure, in a minute. Come on, it's a slow burn, right? It's a slow burn. He goes on. He says, yet you sweep people away in the sleep of death. And he's talking about you and I, by the way, right here. He's talking about you and I. He says, you sweep people away in the sleep of death. They are like the new grass in the morning. All right, he's talking like a new baby being born. Like, oh my gosh, look how cute they are. They're right at the beginning of their life. They got their whole life ahead of them. He's like, in the morning, it springs up anew. Oh my gosh, look at it. It has its whole life ahead of it. But by evening, it is dry and withered and it dies. And in a moment, he's going to tell us, he's like, you know, most of us, we got like 70 years, 80 years in this life if we're lucky. I mean, Moses gets 120 years. Think about that. I mean, he's got way more experience and perspective than you and I have. And Moses is like, you know, I guess from your perspective, God, our entire lives, and we get so jacked up when things don't go in the time we want. And yet, in your perspective, we're like grass. I mean, we're like, our lives start, and we're like a piece of grass comes up, and later on, the sun comes out, it withers, it dies at the end of the day. Isn't this so exciting? Aren't you glad you came today? You're like, woo, so exciting and motivating. Hang with me. He goes on, he says, our days may come to 70 years or even 80 if we're lucky, if our strength endures. And yet the best of them, meaning you're in my years, are but trouble and sorrow. So Moses is like, if you've got a lot of trouble and sorrow going on in your life, and you're just like, oh man, it's been rough, it's been difficult. He's like, let me just like give you a little context and remind you of my story. He's like, 40 years, for 40 years, I was a shepherd out in a field, just watching the sun come up and go down. And then I went to the, like, let my people go, and I was, you know, in the middle of this whole thing, you know, in Egypt, and then all of a sudden, for 40 years, again, I'm walking around in circles in the desert. You know, people just complaining and grumbling. And then I get right to the edge of the place that God said, hey, I'm taking you to a special place, a promised place. And God's like, oh yeah, you can't go in. What again was that story of pain you were talking about? I mean, you know, it's like, dang, Moses, you win. I mean, your story, like, that's rough. That's rough. And Moses is like, yeah, I know, but like the point is not my story. The point is don't lose faith. Don't lose faith, even though you're dwarfed by like God's greatness and when things don't move in the time that you want, because God's time is different than your time. Don't lose faith. And then here's what he says next. He says, for they, talking about the years, they will quickly pass and fly away. Now, this is probably for a few of us. Anybody grew up singing the song, I'll Fly Away, as a kid in church? Oh, gosh, a couple of you, yeah. So that's what this song refers to, right? This is Moses that you were singing about. They're his words, right? You probably didn't know that, but there you go. You know, this is Moses. So he says, if only we knew, meaning if only we could comprehend, if only we could fully understand your power, the power of your anger and of your, look at this word, wrath. We don't like that word, wrath. Your wrath is as great as the fear that is your due. Which, that's just like a really badly constructed sentence right there, right? Like it's like three different ideas with a whole bunch of words in between. So that's the difficulty of like Hebrew going to English and it making sense. So let me tell you what it means, not just like what it says right there in the English translation. The big idea right here is if we could see God as he is, think about this for a moment. If we could see God as he is, we'd give him the reverence or the attention or the, ooh, wow, you're okay, so you really know what you're talking about, that he is due. Meaning, God, you're everlasting to everlasting. I mean, my life, it's like here today, gone tomorrow. I mean, I'm like a piece of grass that grows in the morning, and by the end of the day, I'm dried up and died. I mean, my life is like a flash to you. I mean, I'm just this like itty-bitty, tiny, tiny, tiny little existence in your long continuum of time that I have something to do with in that little flash of a moment. And so we don't think like this very often, but this is why it's good to let Moses give us a little bit of context, and it's good every now and then to pause and just think about really the brevity of really how short in the big picture our lives really are. Because what he's about to show us is that when we contemplate and think about, like just, man, we really don't have that much time, your life, my life, it begins to directly impact how we choose to like use the time that we have. So here's the application right here. Here's where he gets into like the practical application. And again, we've looked at this before at Crosspoint, I don't know, 4 or 5 years ago, maybe 10 years ago, if you've heard this, and you're like, oh, I think this sounds familiar, fantastic. I'm so glad you remember it. I look at this almost every year because my life is different this year. So here's what Moses says next. Teach us, because see, you and I don't do this naturally. He says, teach us to number our days. Now, another way to say that is teach us to live as if our days are numbered. Now this past week, like some of you, I took my kids back to, two of my college age kids back to campus. And it was like a little bit of a, it was so good to have them home, and yet it was so short, felt like the time just flies by, and we get them in like short snippets now. And Julie and I had a pretty long conversation about that, and just, you know, and then just the reality that our other two kids who are at home, in 5.5 years, like, we're going to be empty nesters, and, like, they're all going to be off on their own, and we just live sometimes like our kids are always going to be home, and we live like, you know, we're always going to have as much time as we want with our spouse, and, you know, we live as if time is unlimited, but it's not. I mean, we live like our days aren't numbered, and Moses is like, no, don't do that. All right, you need to learn to live as if your days are actually numbered. Now, as you heard earlier, we got a really cool moment coming up in a couple weekends, baby child dedications, which are just, fantastic, fun weekends, and just a great moment for the Crosspoint tribe and great moment for families as they bring their children and say, hey, we recognize these are gifts from God, and we want to just ask God's blessing on our kids, and we want to commit ourselves as parents to like raising them in a way that is going to help them have the best shot of following Jesus possible. And, you know, there's great moments. And one of the cool things that happens on that weekend, one of the gifts, I guess, that the families walk away with is something called a legacy marble jar. We give one of these to every single family. And so it's like this right here. It's a jar that each family will get to represent each child. And they take it home with them. And it's got 936 marbles in it. One marble for every week between birth and when they hit the age of 18 and get ready to go to college. And the whole point of it is, you know, over the years, you know, every month or so, I don't do it weekly, but you take out like 4 or 5 marbles every month, depending on how many weeks there are, and it just reminds you of how much time you have left. And so just kind of as an illustration, the two kids, I mean, two of my kids' jars are empty because they're adults, but like the two I have left at home are right here. This is my one daughter right here. She's got 291 weeks left. And, you know, in our home, and this one only has 131. And I just look at this and I go, oh my gosh, like where'd the time go? And it's really cool, though, because it reminds me that, like, this is actually real. Like, you know, I don't have unlimited time. And so, you know, if you want to be a part of baby child dedications, I mean, you can scan that, let us know. If you want to find out more, we'd love for you to be a part of that. But, like, these are just some really cool reminders for me personally. Teach us to number our days. This is what Moses says. And then here's the promise. There's a promise at the end of this application. Teach us to number our days that, meaning this goes somewhere. It takes us to some destination that we may gain. All right, you ready to see like what he says? Here's what you're going to get. If you will begin to look at life and say, okay, I got limited days. He says, if you'll begin to look at life this way, you're going to gain something. Here's what you're going to gain. You're going to gain a heart of wisdom. He says, teach us to number our days. Because we like to live as if our days aren't numbered. We like to live as if we're going to have our kids, you know, for unlimited days in our homes. And what he says is when you begin to look at life and you go, oh my gosh, I get wisdom when I begin to realize I've got limited amounts of days. I just see life differently. And all of a sudden, I begin to see more clearly what I should put into my days and what I should not put in or I should take out of my days. Immediately, all of a sudden become wiser. As we're going to see in a moment, all of a sudden you have this perspective, oh my gosh, I can't do that anymore. Oh my gosh, I need to make sure I add this in because this is missing, or I need to dial this up a bit, or I need to turn this down because we're spending too much time on this. Not take it out completely, but we need to, just kind of put some priorities on other things. And so backing up from what Moses just showed us right here, here's kind of a summary statement of what he's saying. He's saying, remembering my time is limited actually gives me insight to know how to spend my limited time. Now, I want to tell you about a lady you've probably never met before, a lady by the name of Bronnie Ware. Bronnie is an Australian nurse, and Bronnie spends most of her time caring for patients in the last 12 weeks of their life, usually the last week or even a few days or hours. She's a hospice nurse. And a number of years ago, she started asking her patients a question, just one question about, the time she would spend with them, caring for them. And she shares this in her blog that's now a book that's called The Top 5 Regrets of the Dying. And she kind of shares this question that she asked her patients, which was, do you have any regrets? Now that you're in the last 12 weeks or week or even a few days or even hours, do you have any regrets? And she began to see a pattern. And so today, I'm gonna fast forward you a bit and help you get some perspective that you're not going to be able to get any other way. And so I'm going to show you the top five things Bronnie kind of just saw rise right to the top as she asked this question. It typically that came from people that knew their days were numbered or even hours were numbered. And due to time, because the clock's getting away, I'm going to kind of quickly go through the first three and just kind of read them, and then I'm going to spend more time on the top two. All right, so here they are in reverse order. Number five, you guys ready? I wish I had let myself be happier. You might want to get your phone out. There's something you might just want to screenshot at the end. Number four, I wish I had stayed in touch with my friends. Number three, I wish I'd had the courage to express my feelings. And then the top two, this is interesting because I thought number two would actually be number one, but this was surprising. Number two, regret. I wish I hadn't worked so hard. Now we've heard that before, right? That's nothing new. But here's what Bronnie wrote in her book about what she heard. She says, this came from every male patient I nursed. Think about this for a moment. Every male patient I nursed said, I wished I had not worked so hard. They missed their children's youth and their partner's companionship. Women also spoke of this regret, but as most were from an older generation, many of the female patients had not been the breadwinners. All of the men, think about this, all of the breadwinners, so that if you're a woman, you're a breadwinner, all of the breadwinners I nursed deeply regretted spending so much of their lives on the treadmill of their work existence. Whew, wow. You can thank Bonnie for that if you ever get a chance to meet her. See, what she's saying right here is for men, for women, especially people who are breadwinners, it means that if we don't learn to number our days and look at our days and realize they're numbered, we're going to misspend our days, our hours, our life. And at the end, you know what's going to happen? You're going to have avoidable regrets. Because see, we think we have all this time in the world with our kids. We have all this time in the world with our spouse. We have all this time. And suddenly we realize, oh my gosh, I don't have all that. And I can never go back to my 20s. I only get to go through my 20s once. And I only get to go through my 30s once. And I only get to go through my 40s, twice, and we redo it after we get to 49. I mean, but at the end of the day, this is so important. Listen, you know, this is from men and women who got to the place where they didn't have a choice anymore. Their days were literally numbered. They couldn't avoid the fact that they had unlimited days because they didn't. It perhaps was even hours. And that's the wisdom that they shared. And then the top regret. You guys ready for the top regret? Before I show it to you, let me just say, you know, if you've kind of dialed out for a moment, you're like, I got a lot of years left. If you're a teenager, if you're, you know, young, you know, you're like, I don't know. Here's the top regret. You're going to want to dial back in for this one. Because teenagers, college students, you have the most time to make the biggest difference. Number one, I wish I had the courage to live a life true to myself, not the life others expected of me. Let me say that one more time. I wish I had the courage to live a life true to myself, not the life others, culture, friends, boyfriends, girlfriends, expected of me. This is a staggering reality right here. Now, here's what she said about this. She said, this was the most common regret of all. When people feel like their life is almost over and they look back clearly on it, it's easy to see how many dreams have gone unfulfilled. Most people had not honored even half of their dreams and had to die knowing that it was, and this is amazing right here, look at this, that it was due to choices they made or didn't make. And then this is even more amazing. Health, think about this. Health brings freedom that very few realize until they no longer have it. Wow. Man, Bronnie did us a favor right here because she fast-forwarded us to the end. I mean, there's a wisdom that comes from people who get there and go, oh my gosh, like this is what I've discovered. What do you do with that? What do you do with that as you look at your current schedule, as you think about the current pace that you're going? What are you doing when you realize, you know, like I often do, I have very little space between my pace and my limits. Lord, give me the wisdom. Give me the wisdom that comes with knowing that my days are numbered. And I know what your pushback is, because it's the same pushback I have, all right? It's just that I have the mic, and I get to talk, and you don't. So, you know, but I know it. I feel it like you do. You're like, Kurt, what if I can't, what if I don't do everything and do as much as I can, I'm never going to make it. And of course, I would say, what is it? What is it? And you're like, I don't know. I just know I won't make it, all right? Do you know what Bronnie would say? You know what Bronnie would say based on talking to people in her book? She says this. She would say, hey, you better really make sure you know what the heck it is, because you could spend your whole life chasing it and get to the end of your life and realize, oh my gosh, I was chasing the wrong thing. Because somewhere along the way, we decided what it is, and we thought, man, this is what I got to chase. And if you're a follower of Jesus, or if you're intrigued by followers of Jesus, you're inspired, you're like, man, I want to dig more into what it means to follow Jesus. Here, this is even bigger. Think about this for a moment. Because see, I, as a follower of Jesus, I believe God has a plan for every single one of your lives and a plan for my life. I believe he has a plan for your kids and your kids' lives and a plan for your marriage and a plan for, you know, your job and work life and how he's going to use you to bless people and be a bright light in the community and how he wants to help other people see him so that they can experience what you've experienced. And I think he has a plan for single people. Now, if you're single, perhaps you have a little more white space, a little more space that's not being dictated by other people in your life. And yet it's so easy for others to start dictating and telling you should live this way and do this. And you could spend your whole life, think about this, you could spend your whole life never having even defined what it is. And God said, no. I want you to live as if your days are numbered. Because, man, when you do this, you will automatically begin to see things differently. Now, we're going to help you with this a little further. All right, we're going to actually make this very tangible. We're going to give you a homework assignment. All right, who's ready for some homework? You guys ready for some homework? All right, so what I want you to do, here's how this is going to work. I want you to reach in front of you, those of you in the room, and there's a card and a pen in the cup holder. You can take this with you, you can take the pen. Some of you have been asking for pens. Like, I love the pens. And so take this with you. Online, if you're tuning in, you can screenshot this. You can go to the connection card. This is printed in the connection card for you. And so what I want you to do is I just want you to fill this out. And here's how it kind of works, all right? So I want you to think through the top line, the plus line. What do I need to add to my schedule that's currently not there at all? What do I need to add? What am I going, oh my gosh, in light of the time that my days are numbered, what do I need to add in? It's pretty self-explanatory. The second one, the subtraction sign. What do I need to remove completely? Now this is a tough one. Let me say a couple things about this. You might need to put a name there. Perhaps for some of you, even a series of initials. All right, and if I could be so bold, some of you know there are people in your life, a person, and they are just sucking you dry. They are like, put a straw on you and suck me dry. And you know it. And your close friends have told you, and your parents have told you, and you know it. You're like, but they're nice people. And it doesn't mean they're not nice. It doesn't mean they're bad people. It's just that they're taking way too much of your time, and at the end of the day, you don't have anything to show for it. It might be friends. It might be weekend things. It might be, you know, as a couple. Maybe you have a couple and you spend a lot of time and they always want to be with you, but you're like, every time we walk away, I just feel depleted and I just feel like it's taking so much and yet I'm not walking away with anything. Maybe for this season, something just has to go. What's that thing that just needs to be removed right now? And then on the next line, what do I need more of? What do you want to turn up? What's the greater thing I want to maybe dial up in my life? You know, maybe it's something in a relationship or something with your faith that you're just like, man, I need to prioritize being more connected to people or in service or online, whatever it might be. What do I need to turn up? And then the last one, what do I need to dial down? What do I need less of? Maybe you can't get rid of it completely, all right? But you're spending way too much time on it. As a couple or a family, you know, where are you spending time? You're like, yeah, we need to dial that down. You know, you can't throw away all the TVs, right? But maybe a few of them. Like, we just need to do a little less of that. You know, maybe it's golf. I don't know. I mean, dial it down. I quit playing golf a long time ago, so it's easy for me to say golf. Quit playing golf, you know. What do you need to dial down? See, the point is, this is a life changer, this card you're holding. Because this will change how you use your time. And your time is your life. And if you're in a small group, I hope you'll talk about it. Some of our groups have already started, and I hope you talk about this. You don't need a curriculum. Just what'd you write down? I hope you'll talk about it with your kids, with your family, if you're married, with your spouse, with your partner. God, teach us to number our days that we might gain a heart of wisdom. All right. So we're going to do something different. You guys ready to do something different? You like different stuff? Okay. So I'm gonna give you in-class homework time, all right? So I'm gonna give you a little space to do your homework, because if I send you out and say, hey, do this when you leave, you're gonna lose it in your car that's a mess, or you're gonna put it on your desk and it's gonna get buried. And honestly, we walk out of here like, oh man, that was amazing. Maybe you don't say that. And you're like, but you just move on. You forget to do your homework. So Mark, do we have a song like that would be inspiring, like remind us, like, man, we need to use our time the best, because today there's amazing things happening today. We have something like that? Iconic, well-known.
Yeah, I think so. You guys got something? Think band.
Okay.
Think we could? Okay.
All right, can we do it? Let's do it. Oh, yay, okay, this is perfect. All right, so it's homework time. What do you need more of? What do you need less of? What do you need to remove? What do you need to add? As you're listening, let's fill it out.
Hot as blue. Shoots up through the stony ground. There's no room.
Let's give these guys a hand, man. Inspiring us, giving us a little space, a little homework time. I tell you what, I hope that you were able to write some things down on this list, because this will give you some giant God-sized perspective. It'll begin to trickle down into your life and your schedule. And honestly, when you walk out of here, I mean, you're going to walk out with wisdom in a way that you just didn't come in with. And see, here's the cool thing. Did you know this is the life? I mean, you know, this song just said, hey, take me to that other place. I mean, that place beyond what I have right now. Do you realize this is where Jesus invites us to go? That's the invitation. If you'll just follow me in these ways and orient your life on my principles, man, you're going to experience life in an entirely different way. Teach me. Teach me to live as if my days are numbered. And when I do, man, I'm going to gain a heart of wisdom. Hey, let's go ahead and stand. We're gonna do something again a little different as we kind of wrap up here. Usually I would pray for you guys, and I'm not gonna say an out loud spoken prayer. In fact, we're gonna sing a prayer. We're gonna close with a song that is a prayer. And if you sing, you like to sing, man, sing along with us and make this your prayer. If you're like, Curt, I don't sing. I don't even know how to do that. Just stand here, just soak this in. Because see, here's what I believe. I believe that when we get intentional and begin to say, okay, God, here's some of the things I'm going to do that are based on your principles and the way you created life to work, it's like a partnership with Jesus, and he begins to get involved. He's like, oh my gosh, you're wanting to go somewhere. You're showing me you want to go somewhere, and his spirit begins to like kind of boost your sails, and his spirit just kind of brings courage and you know, frees us from things perhaps that we've not been able to get free of on our own. And I just believe Jesus wants to do that based on what you wrote down. And where you say, hey, here's some of the moves I'm going to make. I think God wants to bless that. And so we're gonna sing this song, and you can sing it, you know, and this will be our prayer for all of us. If you just need to let this soak in, just whatever that looks like for you, just be encouraged, because you don't have to do this on your own. You actually have a God. You have the power of Jesus who actually will come and can actually begin to make this a reality.
Oh, Excited to have you join us here today. And that's our prayer for you today, that you would come to know and see that a Heavenly Father has the power to remove the things that are holding you down so you can live life with more peace and more weight space. And here's the cool thing. As you follow this lead, life is so much better, and we are so much better at life. So be encouraged. Now, if you'd like for someone to pray with you today, simply text the keyword "need prayer" to 317-834-7373. And a member of our prayer team will be in touch with you today. And if you'd like what you experienced here and you'd like to donate, you can do so on the online Joy Box by going to the Give button at the top of the screen and make a donation, and know that you're part of fueling all the goodness that comes out of this place. Have a fantastic week, and we hope to see you next time for part 3 of White Space.
Jesus from the mountains.